I'll just very briefly set the stage for the discussion. Each one of the participants will make a brief presentation. I'll ask a question or two, and then we'll open to the floor, and hope you get a good conversation going. So, internet governance refers to who gets to decide what the internet looks like and how it should work. And one question that we need to ask first is, how did it evolve to this particular point? And the briefest explanation I've been able to come up with in my researches on the internet was that the original Defense Department internet set up by the United States government, as you know, was designed to allow computers to speak to each other in the event of an emergency, most likely a nuclear attack. But it evolved as different institutions within the government asked if they could sign in. Other institutions and other countries began to ask if they could join in. And towards the late 1980s, the United States government began to withdraw direct involvement in the internet to allow private sector players to start to act. And eventually, a series of private nonprofit organizations were established to run the thing, the most important of which was the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, known as ICANN, based in Los Angeles. ICANN has an international board of directors, but it still ultimately reports to the Department of Commerce. And as the internet got to become what the internet is, especially in the last decade, there were an increasing number of voices who questioned whether it was right and proper that the United States government should continue to have final authority over this most vital technology on the planet. But the United Nations began hosting meetings and conferences to discuss whether the United Nations or some other multilateral forum should assume responsibility for internet governance. And these voices grew exponentially. When it was revealed last year that the National Security Agency had been monitoring massive amounts of communications, including internet communications, raised even more doubts as to whether the United States should, in fact, be given and permitted to have this kind of responsibility. So who governs the internet? Who should govern the internet? The Americans or the global community? How can we best ensure the openness of communication and security of the information that we communicate? Who should we trust? And this is what we're going to talk about today. And our first speaker is Laura Denardis. You have the biography of all the speakers in your program notes. She is professor of economics at American University. She's going to go first. Laura.
Thank you very much, John, and good afternoon, everyone. I'm absolutely delighted to be here, and I wish to thank CG and INET for organizing this wonderful event. Discussions about internet governance often focus on the goal of promoting democratic values of free expression and access to knowledge, but there is much at stake for innovation and for economic activity in how the future of internet governance unfolds. Think about how global commerce and financial transactions are completely dependent upon cyber infrastructure in order to function. Economic growth in developing countries is predicated upon the reliability and also the growth and availability of cyber infrastructure. And new innovation and growth to go from 3 billion users to 5 billion requires certain virtual resources, such as what's called internet protocol addresses, in order to continue. Now, this growth and success of the internet is not at all preordained. We're not technological determinists and just assume that technology will continue the way it has gone. Nothing is preordained here. Now, how the internet is governed is in a constant state of flux, just like technology is, and it's under steady pressure from economic and political forces that have a stake in the outcome. I recently wrote a book about this called The Global War for Internet Governance, which was published this January by Yale University Press. And I decided to select a provocative title for this because I really do believe that debates over certain internet control points are spaces where economic and political power decisions are being made in the 21st century. The point to make is that there are internet control points. Everyone in this room knows that. These mediate civil liberties like freedom of expression and privacy. They're entangled with national security, but they also absolutely affect global innovation policy and economic development. But this whole area has been so technically complex and so institutionally concealed under a sea of acronyms that it really hasn't been in front of the public sphere. Well, that's starting to change a little bit. Think about just the last 3 years alone. We had WikiLeaks releasing sensitive diplomatic cables. And then that was interesting in and of itself, but there was a battle at the level of infrastructure over this, whereby financial companies cut off the flow of funds to WikiLeaks, and information intermediaries like Amazon cut off the websites for WikiLeaks. And then in turn, hackers attack those private companies. There's always a subterranean battle that lies underneath content. In the United States, we had Hillary Clinton's famous internet freedom speech calling upon private industry to push back against the repressive requests for censorship and surveillance. And then fast forward to this year, we have suffered from cognitive dissonance looking at that statement and the disclosures that Edward Snowden made about the NSA surveillance. Think about Egypt cutting off internet access and cutting off the economic flows. There's a very interesting economist at the American University in Cairo who did a paper on the cost of that kind of cutting off of access. And now, in the news just in the last few weeks, we have the decision by the United States to transition, or to follow through with its promise to transition, its unique oversight over certain scarce resources related to the internet to a more international body. And that's being politicized in the United States as Obama's internet surrender on one hand, and on the other hand, people saying it's no big deal. Well, it is a big deal. It's not a non-event. It's symbolic, and it's important because there is a lot at stake. So what do we have happening? On one hand, we have every aspect of our economic lives dependent upon the internet. We have entire business sectors depending on the internet in order to function. And on the other hand, we have a loss of trust. We have a loss of trust in technology, to a certain extent in the institutions that manage the internet, and to a certain extent in governments that are involved in this, and by default in private industry. So hence the rising political attention to internet governance. And there's a moment of opportunity right now to be engaged in these debates. What I'd like to do is just quickly mention three debates that are going on that have a direct tie to innovation. And I'm going to try to do it without wearing my engineering glasses, because some of it is very technical. I'll start with a question that makes no sense. I often get asked the question, as do many in this room, who should control the internet? Should it be the United Nations, the US government, Google, or ICANN? And that question makes absolutely no sense because it treats internet governance as a monolithic system when in fact it's decentralized, it's distributed, and there are a number of different functions. Nevertheless, there are centralized control points. So one question that's of a technical and economic concern is the question about who should control names and numbers. So you understand what names are, domain names such as CNN.com that are necessary to get on the internet. But there are also virtual resources called numbers or internet protocol addresses that are used by computers. Now the requirement for this function to be globally unique has necessitated a form of centralized oversight. And that's where the US government has come in. At one point, it was managed by a single person, John Postel, and then it expanded over time to an institution. And the institution is called ICANN, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. So why is this an economic issue? There are 4.3 billion internet addresses under the prevailing standard. You could do the math, but that's not quite enough for everyone wanting to get online. That's just one small economic scarcity issue involved. There's a new standard. For a variety of reasons, has not been implemented to any great extent to solve that problem because of socio-political issues. So how do we move these things forward, and who should be in charge of this? And so the question I want to raise is, what should the replacement of the US oversight of this function look like? So that's one issue that's hanging out there. It's not just an economic issue, but also one related to freedom of expression, because some of this function includes authorizing new top-level domains. You know what a top-level domain is? .com or .edu or .info or .biz, .org. Well, should something like .sucks or .sex or .republican or .wine be authorized? And what if a country protests .gay? Who decides whether there should be a new top-level domain like that? And of course, the economic issue of adjudicating trademark disputes. So there's going to be a very important discussion over the next few years on this and what that should look like. I want to raise a second open area, cybersecurity. This is an area of internet governance that is absolutely necessary to support economic innovation and financial systems as well as our speech. Beginning in 1988 with the Morris firm, and I was actually in the university where that was unleashed, and it really shaped my view of internet security, to the more recent Stuxnet code that was unleashed targeting Iranian nuclear control systems. These attacks have become more and more sophisticated. And just this week, we heard about the Heartbleed issue. This affects systems of innovation because the entire system is predicated on trust, that the authentication of a website, that the authentication of a user is who they say they are. So when we don't have that kind of trust, we don't have stable economic systems. And then finally, I want to raise one other open issue that is related to innovation. The internet has been globally successful and has been a space for innovation because we've basically had a universal system. You could argue that maybe we don't have a perfect universal system because if you don't speak English or if you don't have broadband speeds, you have a different experience of the internet as others do. But at the technical level, we have basically had this kind of universal internet. But there's increasing concern about fragmentation. Just think about the question of fragmentation in a post-Snowden era. The response to the NSA disclosures brought about the following reactions. I'll just name a few. The president of Brazil called for a global summit on internet governance, which will take place next week. Reactions have ranged to wanting to route around the United States to avoid switching through the United States, creating walled-off internet services that simply do not interconnect in the US. The Brazilian government originally raised the question of asking US companies to store Brazilian consumer data within their boundaries. German telecommunication providers suggested the development of a walled-off internet that would be designed to stop surveillance at the borders. Cross-border data flows are at risk. An EU official suggested a European Union-specific cloud data service that would be completely separate from what it perceives as US-based cloud providers. So these issues are being worked out. There are a lot of discussions. Over the next 2 years, there will be decisions that determine the future of the internet and therefore the future of how innovation will proceed. I'm very, very happy to be the director of research for one initiative that is addressing some of these issues, the Global Commission on Internet Governance, which will be working over the next 2 years. It's being chaired by Carl Bildt, the foreign minister of Sweden. There are other meetings, there are initiatives, there are commissions, but these debates are very important because the security and the stability of the internet really should rank as a collective action public interest issue on a global scale on par with other kinds of collective action problems like environmental rights, like basic infrastructural systems of water, and like human rights. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here today on this panel to raise some of these issues because I believe that scholarly engagement, public engagement, and policymaker engagement is critical considering what is at stake. Thank you very much.
Sponsored by Chatham House and CG, Center for International Government Celebration, which is also
clarity by paraphrasing what how he started his speech. As he always said, I'm short, so I'll be brief. I will paraphrase that to be, I'm not so short, and I'll do my best to be brief. I did want to also start by saying I am the Deputy Minister of Industry Canada, which is a department dedicated to promoting economic development in the country. We really have two strategic objectives, or two that are very important. One is efficient regulatory frameworks, and the other is promoting innovation. And I think this issue of internet governance, is, as Laura's demonstrated, is really about getting the efficient regulatory framework right in a way that allows you to continue to promote innovation and get strong innovation outcomes. And I suppose that is why within our own department, which is primarily domestically oriented, we have a small unit that is dedicated to working on international internet governance. And they have prepared a paper as background for the discussion today. And they've helped me learn about the issue in ways I did not before. But, so let me just make four or five basic points in terms of where the government of Canada comes in terms of this issue of internet governance. First, it would be our view that the current model of internet governance has been tremendously successful in promoting innovation and the development of the global digital economy. It's basically given us, although there are challenges, as Laura identified, a secure, stable, and resilient internet. And put simply, the Government of Canada supports the system, which is open, private sector-led, decentralized, distributed, and is based on some basic principles such as interoperability, access, and universality. And all to say that the Government of Canada has worked very closely with like-minded countries like the United States to ensure that this stable internet regime is in place that allows for the full opportunities, the innovations related to internet. So that's my first point. My second point is really not about governance, but it is about innovation. And I would just want to point out to you that not from the perspective of how we govern, but the outcomes, really the internet has led to incredible innovation in terms of an open tool, if you like, as well as its non-proprietary protocols and end-to-end design allow users to experiment at the edges of the network without having to request permission. So it's a permissionless innovation tool. So just two concrete examples of the benefits of the internet, and I'm sure many of you could offer more. First, Skype. Skype's voice over internet protocol telephone service is a great example of the benefits of innovation. No one asked for permission to build it as a service or to put it on the internet. It just did. People liked it and used it. And now the result is a business model that has introduced competition and lowered the price of long distance calls. There's lots of good Canadian examples. The one that I have before me is Shopify, where they have delivered e-commerce platforms to help run online stores. I think we could go on in terms of the, examples of benefits of innovation from internet. Second basic point is just around what is the role of government and what does government do? And I'm speaking now from the point of view of the Government of Canada. And I think there's sort of, there are four basic activities. First is investing in infrastructure, and the Government of Canada has intervened in markets where it was determined that there was a lack of sustainable business case, primarily in rural and remote areas. And through joint initiatives, the federal, provincial, and territorial governments have collaborated to increase the availability and speed of broadband services. And just in the last budget, we announced $305 million for another round of rural broadband investment. Second role for government is setting an enabling regulatory framework domestically and then working internationally to ensure that what we're doing domestically is compatible with that. And the government has an important role to play in ensuring that this is efficient and supportive of the outcomes we want related to innovation. We have just announced just earlier in the week, late last week, I should say, what's called the Digital Canada 150 Initiative. It's a digital economy strategy. And in there, just as examples of the kinds of things we focus on as the Government of Canada, is our privacy legislation. The acronym is PIPEDA, Personal Information Protection Electronic Documents Act. We've passed an anti-spam law, which comes into force July 1st, 2014. And perhaps most importantly, we've modernized our Copyright Act to protect the rights of creators and innovators. And while there are challenges, I think, in the area of the internet, certainly this is a step forward in the right direction. Perhaps I'd also mention, in terms of, again, dealing with national security issues, there are regulatory issues at play with respect to cybersecurity, and Laura mentioned that as an issue. Third, I think, important role for the Canadian government is to support an inclusive, what we call multi-stakeholder decision-making system for the management, particularly of the technical functions related to the internet. And as I said at the outset, these arrangements, while they have been decentralized and distributed, have generally been effective, and they have allowed the stakeholders from across the global internet community to come together and to put in place an effective management system for the internet broadly. Fourth area is just simply our role is not as an intervener, but rather as a convener of stakeholders and partners, and to be a participating stakeholder. In this regard, I'll just refer to the work of SIGI and the events that are going to be held on this issue over the next 9 months, and particularly the conference in Ottawa, where I know my minister, Minister Moore, will be keen to participate. Indeed, I would also go back to the commitments that the Government of Canada has made domestically around the digital economy strategy, and say that that is part of our work in support of an international regime encouraging strong work collectively among stakeholders and partners. Third set of points is just perhaps related to this issue of what role does government have in the international sphere, and particularly in the management of technical matters. And again, from Canada's perspective, we want to ensure that the multi-stakeholder institutions remain agile and are capable of responding to evolving technology, while at the same time strengthening their stability and legitimacy. And the US government has served notice, as I think Laura mentioned, that their dominant role as a historic steward of the domain name system is to change, and we are eager as the Government of Canada to support that change and to look for the appropriate stewardship required in that context. So last set of remarks is just looking to the way forward. As Laura articulated quite clearly, there are challenges with respect to the internet regime. I think generally Canada is confident that we can continue to pursue a balanced approach in terms of how we approach both the economic benefits, the social benefits, and support a single open internet regime. I think this requires a light-handed, principled approach, and I mentioned earlier, and the OECD has documented in detail some of these principles. Basically, we're talking about an open, safe, and accessible regime. And then lastly, I'd say I think the nature of change in this area is truly evolutionary, and that has been partly its strength, that it has been managed to move forward as the technology has changed, and its scope and breadth has changed, and it's truly an incremental process. And the Government of Canada is confident that that evolution will evolve and lead to a strong framework for internet governance. Thanks very much.
keynote speaker is Ni Kunor, who is the founding chairman of Africa.
Thank you very much, and I'm pleased to have a chance to share some of the views from the African continent with you. I've been in the trenches right from the time the internet arrived in Africa, and has been appealing for my community to get involved, as well as for space to be made available for us to participate. I can tell you for sure that the internet arrived in Africa in end of 91, and by 2000, all the countries had access, at least at the capital city. All the countries in Africa had. Certainly, we are grateful, therefore, that the internet had been defined holistically, and that place had been reserved for Africa to come and join, even though we came late. Name spaces were reserved for countries, and likewise, technical normal resources, like what I referred to, were also reserved. And that is why I was able to mobilize to have AfriNIC, the numbers registry for Africa, formed. If there were no numbers for us, it would not have been possible for us to form AfriNIC. It did not have to be, but it was, which tells much about the spirit of the internet. As a side note, recall that several African countries were previously colonies and were engaged in liberation struggles, but this case was different. We were welcomed at a global coordination, and our struggle was more at a national policy environment, and in my opinion, still is. I may elaborate on this a little later. We feel fortunate that the internet was open. Had been closed, we would not be able to learn, we would not be able to acquire the know-how to replicate or develop our own systems. So though we are latecomers, we are satisfied that there were no undue barriers, and therefore are concerned that any change to the current system should not introduce any more barriers for Africans. Recently, a number of organizations, including OECD, World Bank, and so on, have argued about strong correlation between broadband access, infrastructure, penetration, and economic growth. Likewise, the BCG, Boston Consulting Group, further suggested that eliminating certain kinds of frictions makes the internet economy grow worldwide. And even more recently, McKinsey, suggested that internet is transforming Africa, even more so than mobile had done. So I look to preserve this opportunity. Evidently, the success of globalization has been enabled by the internet, which fundamentally is borderless, and this has made the internet an underlying success factor. The internet's design is based on open and multi-layer architecture. Various stakeholders, from internet users, businesses, researchers, protocol developers, policymakers, law enforcement, all influence what's happening on the internet by contributing at different layers. While end users contribute with content, business contributes with innovation, and policymakers contribute with regulations, and others with education, capacity, and so forth. And we are satisfied with that. In Africa, the efforts of the early contributors led to the creation of a community of organizations that we call AFSTAR. And these are supporting various aspects of the internet. And they cooperate to generate new groups of interest, interestingly, which are becoming less and less technical over time. You see groups like African IGF and so on emerging. Some countries in Africa have not only embraced the internet, but they've gone further to propose open government small steps that give me hope that Africa does not want to remain dark and will support an open, stable, and secure internet governed through multi-stakeholder bottom-up policy development processes. Many forget the reality that it is no longer possible to have all expertise for analysis in one organization, and thus it's better to reach out to other outside expertise to obtain answers to issues. National governments will therefore benefit from a multi-stakeholder approach to policy development at the national level as well. I think Africa should act quickly as the landscape is changing. Africa is playing catch up as a supplier of internet goods and services. However, Africa showed a hand in mobile internet and payments. Would Africa be ready to be a player in Internet of Things? Let's take the challenge and get over internet governance and move the internet into the industry in Africa. In other words, for me, the global governance is not an issue. It's a local governance where the rubber meets the time meets the road is where the action should take place. Let me conclude remarks on where the struggle for internet has been. From the introduction of internet in Africa, pioneers have had to push against policy, local policy environments, which had been too often telco-centric. Some enthusiasts had their business shut down, I was one, for various reasons. And it's ironic to see the very African governments that resisted the introduction of internet to Africa now want to control it. I reckon it will not succeed, and the multi-stakeholder processes will prevail. We need simply more infrastructure, broadband, exchange points, we need education, capacity for various things, cooperation between governments and private sector, and investments. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that, Nick. What I'd like to do is limit myself to one question for each of the three participants. While I'm doing that, you can get ready with questions in your own. So, Flora, to you, you raised a number of very interesting questions about the challenges facing the oversight of the internet and internet governance. I guess the question would be, what do you think the oversight of the internet should look like? How should it differ from the way, from the status quo that we have today? If you were in charge, what would you do?
I would actually push back on that question and say, I don't know that it should be that different. The reason that the internet has been so successful is because of what's called the multi-stakeholder model, where it's been led by private industry. It has evolved to a certain extent, and not enough, from civil society. And there are expert-based institutions that cover different aspects of the internet. And yes, there has been this unique relationship of the US government to one narrow area. But the reason that that has operated OK is because the United States government has had a very hands-off approach, always intended to transition that function. And I would say that what shouldn't happen is for this multi-stakeholder model to move towards a model in which one stakeholder has outsized power. So I would say preserving the multi-stakeholder model is the answer, and not moving to something like an intergovernmental model in which governments have a much stronger hand in what has always been a very rapid environment for innovation.
Of course, reporters always say one question and they grab the subject next week. Are you sure the United States does not itself have too much power as a stakeholder?
The US government has had more power than any other government in the management of critical internet resources because of the historic way in which the internet has evolved over time. And I just have to say that the very formation of this institution, ICANN, was an attempt by the United States government to privatize and internationalize a function that had been done within the government. So yes, there has been more power in that particular area, but that is, since the 1990s, the intention has been to transition that.
Thank you. John, you heard about the fact that Brazil, the government of Brazil, and other countries are starting to more or less formally organize a process that would, in fact, produce fundamental shifts, that might, in fact, see the internet and the governance of it be taken over in a way by the United Nations itself. Now, look, the International Civil Aviation Authority does a darn fine job of keeping the planes in the air. Should Canada resist greatly any attempt by other countries to actually change the status quo? And how strongly do you think, you're getting some country right away, how strongly do you think Canada would resist any change to the status quo?
I'll build on Laura's answer, which I think Canada wants to continue to support working with like-minded countries like the United States, this multi-stakeholder model, which in fact promotes an open private sector-led approach to the internet and its governance. I think it now wants to work with all countries in terms of the ICANN issue and the transition that is about to happen with respect to the United States role there, and we'll be meeting shortly in that regard. Maybe I'd emphasize one other point that I didn't emphasize in my remarks, which is Canada is also committed to ensuring that the economic and social benefits of the internet are distributed to other developing countries. And we've been working hard with others through the various institutions to ensure that that is done, including with Africa. And that is a priority for the
Thank you. And me, you spoke glowingly, really, in many ways about the opportunities that the internet offers to Africa and that Africa has been offered in the searching the earlier years. When you look at debates like this and the reports that you see, do you see anything on the horizon that you think Africans should be worried about in terms of changes in governance structures that could affect the accessibility of Africa to all of the potential that the internet offers?
Yeah, I do. I think any change that means more efforts from the African community, which is already behind, means we'll fall more behind. So when I hear statements about, you know, intergovernmental approaches and so on, or new bodies to be created, my feeling is this is a scheme to slow me down. What I'm looking for is how to enhance the current multi-stakeholder processes, the bottom-up policy processes, and how to strengthen Africa's participation so that our contribution will become larger than it is now, and therefore the benefits to us also improve. So if it, for instance, involves more travel, then it's not in our interest. We don't have the funds to do it. If it involves, a new organization that we have to find people to participate in, it's not for us, because we are already too few. And so by asking a change that is drastic, I think it will not be in our interest. Now, however, the change is to evolve the existing process by having internal structures within the SCI can, as an example, then it becomes easier because we already have learned to go to ICANN, we have found ways to sponsor ourselves to get to ICANN. Then we could grow into those, and if it requires new skills, we could then prepare some people who are specialized in stewardship, for example, to participate in those bodies. But the moment it gets larger than that, I am concerned to slow us down.
That's a fascinating. So, just raise your hand, stand up, speak loudly. I will paraphrase it if I think the room needs to hear what it is you're actually asking. The first hand was the gentleman at the back.
Good afternoon, everybody. Earl Fogel from FCS. I have a question for both Laura and the Minister. It's a rather controversial question because it touches on both sides of the debate. Our research has been mainly focused on the internet and the developing capacity within Africa and within the developing countries. Now, the establishment of an independent, multi-governmental authority, our question is mainly this: is not this focusing of all this data, is it not the first step of establishing a rather controversial idea of world governance, like the United Nations, because he who controls the data flows, at the end of the day, controls the population? I understand it's a very in-the-air question, but I would like to hear your response. Thank you.
Could you just elaborate, what are you referring to when you say a multi-governmental organization, the ITU, or I'm not sure what you're referring to?
We're referring at the moment to the potential for a different ICANN, a self-governing ICANN, which is no longer under control of a certain single government. And we would just like to know if this is potentially the establishment or the initial building block of a United Nations that would control.
I certainly hope not, and that is not the intention. In fact, ICANN right now has an advisory role with governments. It's called the GAC. Everything is an acronym in this. It's the Governmental Advisory Committee. But it also has major participation of private industry and civil society input. And you could argue, even with all its faults, it's quite multi-stakeholder. And what you're raising is the possibility of this moving from that type of multi-stakeholder innovation to an intergovernmental organization. And I don't think that's going to happen. In fact, it certainly is not going to happen in the short term. When the Department of Commerce in the United States announced that it would relinquish its historic oversight, it specifically laid down some conditions. And one of those conditions was to not have an intergovernmental organization or another government have an oversight capacity.
Basically, my answer is the same as Laura. Maybe I would just add that two things. One is Canada is the chair of this GAC and has been eager to work effectively in that context from this multi-stakeholder model perspective. And the second is I think the real issue here is, can you ensure that the multi-stakeholder model is transparent, inclusive, and open? I think these are the principles that need to be focused on and ensure that the governance associated with this multi-stakeholder model meets those principles.
Thank you.
Fenn Hampson from CG. You're up.
Yes, we're
good. Fenn Hampson from CG. Question to all of the panelists. One of the things we're seeing in the commercialization of the internet are all kinds of pressures for rent-seeking behavior, and various arguments being put forward that one of the ways you deal with congestion effects on the internet is through various kinds of user pay principles, which can also be seen as rent-seeking behavior. Is it your view that ultimately these debates will be resolved at the national level, or is there a role for those who are looking at the challenges of internet governance at the global level to weigh in on these kinds of issues?
Lee, do you want to start with that?
Okay. This is the net neutrality argument, I imagine. I imagine. But I am for an open internet. I don't want my traffic to be unduly touched, as long as it is lawful traffic. Remember, I'm coming from very far away, so if such things begin to occur, actually could end up slowing me down. I'm trying to get my community to jump across. And so if people for various rent-seeking opportunities begin to filter the traffic from Africa because we don't buy enough bandwidth, I think that would be detrimental to economic growth in the environment. So I'm very much for an open internet. Keep it open. Everybody had it open, and that's how they develop. Why is that when it's my turn? Then people start talking to those. In fact, you should open it wider
I'll jump in. I'll pile on to that a little bit. The basic philosophy behind this is that technology is politics by other means. It's not something that has to be the way that it is. It's socially constructed, it's economically constructed. And the reason the internet is an open playing field in general is because of the way that it has been designed. And I think that the question that Fenn Hamsen raises is a really important one, and it's one that doesn't just reside on the edges. The international community really needs to come together and make cooperative decisions in certain areas that affect the internet as a whole. I want to give you a few examples of how things could be different. Imagine if we go back to the proprietary online systems of the 1990s, where I couldn't send email to Brenda or someone else unless we were all on the same email platform. Well, in fact, that's what we have now in some new applications, where everyone has to be on the same platform in order to communicate. Even an amazing technology like Skype, which I've been using constantly while I've been in Toronto, is a little bit different than email in that it is partially based on proprietary protocols, and it requires a financial arrangement in order to call off Skype, as I understand it. So imagine if email were like that. The internet would not be what it is. Imagine if the web was like that. The internet would not be what it is. And I'm referring to a fairly open technology. Now, as we move into pervasive computing and what's called the Internet of Things, where our clothing has IP addresses in it, our refrigerator has IP addresses, and everything is connected via the internet, we're going to have to decide that the question that Fenn raises about the rent-seeking behavior, because there will be all kinds of new opportunities for that in the future. It's not just the net neutrality issue. It also is an issue that resides in the center of the network.
And I don't know very much about this, but so Laura, I'd like you to, you've sort of gotten at this. What do you predict will come out of this intergovernmental meeting that Brazil has been pushing? That is next week, right? Yeah. And for John and me, are there national governance, I don't know what you call them, governance, no, modes or whatever, the mechanisms that are best practice, and do you benchmark against best practice? And then I look at the program, and it talks about the unemployment, coming unemployment of journalists, among other things, but it also talks about, so it gets at rent-seeking, rent-seeking, how is one able to distinguish meaningful information from sheer falsehood? And I'd like to hear from all three of you on that, in terms of, is that a governance issue? It's here in the program. It is a really important issue because of what can get started through social media by way of falsehood. But I just wonder how you look at it.
Okay, Wendy, that is 17 questions. Let's start with Laura about the meeting in Brazil.
Certainly, there's going to be a meeting next week in Brazil. It's called Net Mundial, and it was called by the Brazilian government after the Edward Snowden revelations about the NSA surveillance. But it has evolved into much more than that. It really is a convention where people are coming together from various governments, civil society, and private industry to discuss the future of the internet. This is not something unique. There are gatherings like this that happen all year long, including the United Nations Internet Governance Forum. I won't go into all the acronyms, but there are a lot of meetings like this that take place all the time. What will come out of the Brazil meeting is an excellent question, and I think the best that we can hope for is a series of principles. We have a lot of sets of principles for the governance of the internet already, but I think we're going to have another discussion about a set of principles, and I think that that probably is what's going to come out of it.
And then if I get it correct, the second question was, are there best case practices in government mechanisms in managing the
Yes, there are best practices in Canada. Maybe I'll just be short and to the point. On this issue of net neutrality, Canada has implemented an internet traffic management framework, and the CRTC announced that and put it in place in 2009. This net neutrality issue is complicated, and rent seeking obviously is something that happens. So I think this is an example of good practice where we're trying to learn better how to actually apply the net neutrality principle. And in relation to the United States, the U.S. is, again, coming at it from the same perspective, but running into some challenges in the court, particularly with respect to this net neutrality principle on rent seeking.
Yes, I know. And the best practices in Africa?
There is an interesting example of Kenya. Before the ministry makes a policy, it tries to reach out to a larger community. And it is the debate in that community that helps prioritize the issues that the ministry takes forward. And I think that's an example that in Canada we would like to also pursue.
Wendy, what we're going to do with that last question, because it is significant, but I want to get to other people here who want to ask questions of their own. Let's set it aside and come back at it a little bit later. That gentleman there in the blue shirt had his hand up first. And then you, sir, over here.
My name is Eric Brun. I came in here not knowing anything about this, and it's been really interesting. Can you expand a little on maybe the opportunities of the U.S. Delegating its responsibility to an international or a different kind of format? I mean, you did a good job explaining the risks already, so thank you.
John, what do you think are the opportunities of delegating ICANN to a different kind of
law? Well, again, I think this perception of the United States as having dominated process of some of these technological issues, I think the reality is probably different than the perception. And so I think partly in the context of lots of debate about this issue, including in Europe, the United States has moved ahead to suggest that we move to a new regime. I think they've identified three or four criteria around which there will be discussion about the next steps. And so there should be a good discussion sort of evolutionary approach to this next steps. And the benefits and the opportunity are all around ensuring a multi-stakeholder model which is open and fair and transparent.
And you turned into the floor. Good for you. You, sir, and then the lady in the back.
Thank you. Andres Rosenthal, CG Board. Laura touched a little bit on it, but not entirely, and that's the issue of the misuse of the internet. One thing is the access, the open access, the non-single stakeholder governance issue. The other is the question of content. And that's one issue which I'd be interested in hearing what you think about it. We regulate and control what is put in the mails. We regulate and control, standard. We regulate and control telecoms. We regulate and control a whole series of things to avoid the misuse of communication channels. And this is, after all, a communication channel. It's probably the one that is the least regulated, the least controlled in terms of what's going on, including things like the deep internet and the use of internet for racism and all sorts of other things to mobilize public opinion. So I'd like to hear a little bit about that.
Need to start. And let's run on a little bit. What, if anything, can or should we be doing beyond the already robust measures that some governments are taking themselves, thank you very much, to control the information that goes across the internet?
I imagine some content policy and use of law to effect the control is required, in the sense that if the law does not permit some hate kind of speech, then the same law can be used through the same course to remove the information. In other words, in my country, for example, some who using the courts, were able to remove those pages. In other words, if there are deficiencies within the laws, we should fix it and lawfully have those contents regulated. Will be the approach that I will look for. In other words, I don't want blanket removal of things or prevention of things from flowing. But if it is backed by rule of law, then it is fair, because you can go to court and get the appropriate things done. That would be the way I would look at it.
Except the rule of law in one country is not the same as the rule of law in another.
Would argue if you'd like to see a rule of law established at board that, that transcends the national jurisdictions of the countries of using, where people use the internet? Law or job?
I think we already have one. It's intellectual property rights. There's a lot of agreement internationally on that. But other than that, the content control mechanisms and the laws that apply, as Andres said, are completely different from nation to nation. And we have a privatization of governance, is the point that I'd like to make, and that the front lines of content control, when you're looking at problems like defamation, intellectual property rights, cyberbullying, hate speech, and all these things are left to the private information intermediaries that have to make decisions. So that's another interesting dimension that further complicates the question.
So the lady in green.
Basma Omani, CG. My question is to... that's okay, Doctor. My question is to Laura and to Neil. I'm wondering whether you can reflect on the phenomena of e-banking and really seeing the spread of banking penetrate into parts of Africa today through mobile banking as well, really using the technology to basically give access to, I think, a group of people that never really had a chance to participate in the financial economy in some way. But at risk of sounding very pessimistic and alertist here, we saw through the financial crisis how the speed at which money can travel can also be a risk. And I'm wondering whether or not we see some point where, again, internet governance will have to come to really start carving out that kind of regulatory space, following up Andreas' question of really finding where can we control things so that we don't see this kind of technology undermining the international financial system with its, again, very rapid flow, and I think clearly the ability to do so in very quick time and have such devastating effect globally.
Well, since Africa is in fact leading the way in all of this, Nicolasar.
As for us, we have embraced the mobile banking. We started from passing units to each other, because oftentimes we have relatives who are far away who don't really have economic capability. But we are able to buy phones for them and have given a phone to your mother somewhere in the village. And in so doing, the mother will flash you, they say. Meaning she will just pretend to call you and then hang up because there's no charge for that. And then you call the mother. Now from there, then we started passing units to them, and then now it has become, currency. And many of the telcos are providing that service. What is happening rather is that the central bank is taking it seriously and requiring that those transfers are switched to the national switching system. In so doing, bring some level of regulation into it and stabilizing the risk that you're referring to. So that's the approach that I'm going for some of the countries.
Is anybody looking very hard at the question of fraud and theft? Because robbing a bank is robbing a bank. And this sounds like one that is very, potentially could be very easy to rob.
You mean you'll be stealing my phone?
Or stealing the money from the phone, electronically.
I imagine all those issues are there. All those issues are there. But once again, I like to fall on the law as the means by which these things are enforced. You know, it's something local must prevent it, and it has to happen.
The gentleman at the back, and there's, by the way, this is a great discussion. Thanks very much for everyone really is pitching in.
Hi, my name is Scott Dunham. Canadian International Council. My question, there was an allusion earlier to private governance. I was discuss the role of large technology companies and ISPs in governance. And as corollary to that, I'd be curious about your thoughts on the surveillance of data that's going on and their complicity in terms of how can we place our faith in governance when we realize that there's all this other activity happening as well.
I have to ask John to start with that. How can we place our faith in governance when we look at governments that are doing to us?
Well, first of all, I think is again, it's a multi-stakeholder model, and there's a place for the larger ISPs, Googles of the world, if you like, in this regime, and they play a very constructive role today.
What is that role, if you could elaborate? What is their specific role in governance?
Well, I think the short answer is they have an interest, given their technologies and their business orientation, to ensure that there's a strong internet governance system. So they're at the table, just like governments are, to ensure that it's effective, that the privacy regime associated with it, for example, or the copyright aspects, or the IP elements, are ones that are effective for all the players in the internet governance system. So again, I come back to the point that while there's always challenges and there is rent-seeking, this system seems to have worked, and the evolution of the system seems to have been effective.
Thank you. And the next one is this gentleman here.
Tied to the last question, the reality that we live in is that we have the technical mediation of the public sphere, which is content, and we have the privatization of our conditions of civil liberties within that public sphere, and I'll explain how that works. We have information intermediaries of various categories, such as search engines, such as social media companies, such as information aggregation sites, such as reputation systems like Yelp that tell us what's a good restaurant in Toronto, and all kinds of other information intermediary sites. They're not creating content, they're mediating content. And what these companies do is they make determinations about how to handle intellectual property rights violations. They make determinations about what counts as hate speech and what doesn't. They make determinations when there's a request to close down a user account because of cyberbullying of a young person, for example. So I could go on and on and on about this governance mechanism. In addition to that, bringing it down into the lower layers of technology, which is what the second question is, even on that front, private industry has led the way in the development of standards, in the development and management of critical internet resources and in interconnection. But even those issues get at the same types of content concerns around innovation and freedom of expression that direct content is involved in. So let me give you just a couple of examples. One, in order to do basic network management, requires something called deep packet inspection, which opens up the contents of a packet, inspects it, and makes a decision about how to route it. This is the reason why there can be net neutrality violations. This is the reason why there can be efficient network management. That would be like a postal worker opening up our envelopes, reading it and making a decision about how to route something. So even a very technical issue like that is related to basic innovation and civil liberties. Even in standard setting, an organization like the World Wide Web Consortium sets accessibility standards for the disabled. So even the very most technical gets into these same kinds of issues as the content control. That's what makes the area so interesting, but it's primarily private sector led.
Open and multi-stakeholder model, whatever the heck that means, from the roots of the internet, I think that the people who were involved in the early internet are really uncomfortable with this kind of conversation. Because they're talking about balancing IP rights and hate speech, and there's an older libertarian voice that is struggling to get itself out, and they're really threatening. Bitcoin is a great example because it's there, and governments are fighting with it, accommodating it, dealing with it, and all of these issues, several of them, not all of them, several of these issues of internet governance, people are working right now to try to undermine all of these processes and put their own kind of distributed version in place of it. So I thought I'd comment on that.
Is it possible, and would it be a good thing?
Well, I'm going to start with you, so John, to think of where the position of the government of Canada is on this.
I want to push back on a couple of assumptions that you made that I disagree with. One is the libertarian position. I think the libertarian position is multi-stakeholder internet governance that's led by the private sector. And then what they would not want to happen is to go to a government-led kind of top-down mandate for how all this is controlled. On the second issue of the distribution of this power into technology, that is theoretically a, you know, as much as we can do that, I'm all for it, but at some point, somebody in a room has to make a decision about whether something like a top-level domain .xxx can be allowed. And someone has to make a decision about who should own .amazon. Should it be the company Amazon or the countries that have the Amazon rainforest in their borders? So even at this distributed technical level, there are decisions that need to be made, and I, in my personal opinion, the best case that we can do is have it be a multi-stakeholder governance model. And I just want to make one other qualification. Not every single area of internet governance needs to be multi-stakeholder, I would suggest, because there are some areas where it's appropriate for the government to handle, like if someone steals my identity, I want to be able to call someone, say, help, or computer fraud and abuse. In other cases, private industry makes private contractual arrangements, and the worst thing that could happen there is to have onerous government regulations. So even though we're saying multi-stakeholder, it depends on what area of internet governance, and the picture, as you're raising, is much more complicated.
The government of Canada agrees with you both.
This gentleman and the fifth gentleman.
We have one here.
Seems that the freedom of expression that we have doesn't help. For example, before the Iraq War, opinion polls showed that in the United States, the majority of the population thought that Iraq was somehow behind 9/11, which is completely untrue. And they had access not only to the biased American media, but also to international media, and it didn't help. I mean, one problem seems to be that many Americans don't speak, for so much. But I think in general that, I mean, starting a war of mass destruction and a war of aggression in a foreign country is a serious problem that we thought could have been helped against by freedom of expression in other countries, but wasn't helped. And I mean, continuously people were kidnapped to Guantanamo and tortured. Nothing happens to the US government. And
what I think what you're suggesting, sir, is that there is out there in the broader community among quite many people, we'll start with the United States now, a huge distrust of the United States and the belief that it cannot and should not be allowed to have its hands on anything so important as the internet, even if it did in fact invent the internet. Would you rather, let's start with you, would you rather have the system we have now, which has American fingerprints all over it, or one in which the General Assembly or some organization designated by the General Assembly was responsible for things that the Department of Commerce is ultimately responsible for now?
Actually, if you reverse the question to him, if he created the internet, would he be saying the same thing? You see, from my point of view, we should be really grateful that someone who created the thing is letting it go, you know, to the extent that he says government should not even get involved, but private sector, other people should do it. And, you know, while I sympathize with the issues of the NSA and so on, it happens in all governments. I bet you if you come to my country, it will listen to you. It's part of the requirements of keeping track of terrorism and other kinds of, you know, misbehavior. Social activity. So that's a separate thing. And remember also that the internet is governed by an ecosystem. It's not just ICANN. You can destroy ICANN, but there's IETF, there's RRs, there are ISPs, and so on. So it's a very distributed structure that is making the internet work. And so it's not that simple for NSA to, in some sense, all of these bodies, and I think that's the beauty of it. The more decentralized it gets, the more difficult, in my opinion, for any one country to control. That would be my response.
I hate moderators who let sessions go on over time, and we have two more questions.
John, do you want to take them one after the other, and then...
Why don't we do that? Panel? So the last two questions.
I'm Alain Pescador from the International Economic Forum of the Americas. This is a simplistic yet more realistic question along the lines of my colleague, but a bit different as well. My question is, I feel that we're forgetting about the bigger picture, which is the protection of ourselves, citizens, and we're focusing too much on technical issues. And my question is, to what extent is it fair that, for example, Bradley Manning is behind bars and demonized by governments all around the world, mainly by Western governments. And then on the other side, you have all this surveillance machineries by governments led by the United States and the NSA and Western governments around the world. And why are governments allowed to spy on people, but when citizens actually do disclose information on governments, they're put behind bars, and why are governments not being put under accountability measurements that would actually put them at the same level as us, the citizens?
With that aside, let's go to the last question over here.
My name is David Leacock. I'm from the University of Toronto, and I strongly empathize with that sentiment. My question is that the government of Brazil just passed the Internet Bill of Rights, and I'm quoting from The Economist, which says that it ensures 100 million Brazilian internet users' privacy by barring providers from rummaging through their data. So my question for the minister and the other panelists, is this an approach that we should consider in the US and Canada?
Well, there are two large questions, which and the day when we end the survey we began. So, Laura?
I'll kind of answer both of those quickly. I would encourage people who are concerned about surveillance, and I'm an American and I believe in the Fourth Amendment and I don't want to be under surveillance, just so you know where I stand. But why are the same people not concerned about the the enormous system of information filtering that's done in China, the way that Russia has a repressive information approach in other countries, I would just encourage you to look at the other approaches and also say that the management of names and numbers has nothing to do with surveillance. Surveillance is possible because of the data that private industry collects about us because of the Faustian bargain in which we get free software goods and we have all of this metadata collected about us. So the question is very complicated. I certainly understand the nature of the questions, but you have to think about internet governance as multiple layers, and some areas are not connected to others, and then some are connected.
Sean?
I'm going to go to the question about journalism.
Okay.
Because I think someone needs to at least say something. I think, obviously, the internet, social media, create challenges for the traditional media world, and that's why it's under the gun, so to speak, and changes are happening in terms of that traditional media. The other side of it, though, is there are huge opportunities with the social media tools that we have, including internet, and that gives really new voices at play an opportunity to access directly citizens in ways that we haven't before. And it even gives those citizens an opportunity to create news themselves.
I agree completely.
So I think the challenge is, and it's easy to say, you can't stop innovation. So journalism has to adapt somehow to what's happening.
I agree completely, by the way, except it's a problem if your pension is vested with one of the old media companies. Last word to you.
I think the balance between privacy and security will remain, okay? Because if there is some knowledge that is going to happen and nobody takes advantage of it to stop the bad thing, you blame the national security. So there's a reason why, you know, these things happen. If we were all of good behavior and no antisocial activity, I'm sure that the surveillance should be reduced. That's my perspective. But given that it's been like this, certainly there will be much more intrigue. Yeah, even the Brazilian government, I'll tell you for sure, they track criminals. And that they can only do it with surveillance. So some of these things are meant for the for the nice talk. But the reality of taking care of the peace in a country is a different story altogether. Now, as for me, I think the media is a big opportunity for Africa because we don't have large New York Times-like, you know, enterprises. So some of the small, you know, individual journalists may even manage to have, you know, global impact, and that's of interest to us.
Well, listen.